Hey everyone, welcome back to A-Level Lessons Online. Hope you're having a fantastic day, good evening, afternoon, and morning to you, wherever and whenever you are watching this. Alright, welcome back to another video from our Human Geography syllabus. Alright, we're going to be moving on in our Team 2.1 content series. We're going to be looking at this new concept today, okay? It's something that we haven't actually dived into yet. Okay, it's called the New International Division of Labor, okay? NIDL for short. It is actually part of your GPN series, okay? I'm thinking of your GDP. Your Global Production Networks, okay? So this is one part of it. It's kind of like the beginning, okay? I would think, okay, of why a GPN is what a GPN is. Okay, I'll go into more details later on in this video. So if you do have any doubts about this topic, okay, because I know it's a topic that a lot of students struggle with, okay, it's not easy to understand, okay, I hope you stick around for the whole video, okay, because I think it should be quite informative, right? So let us go right in. Yeah, all right, so the NIDL, it is basically defined as the spatial arrangement or spatial variations of labor, okay, and it is an outcome of globalization. Okay, globalization, as you know it, is because of things like free trade, right? Increasing advancements in technology has led to globalization. So a more interconnected society has also resulted, okay, in a greater shift of labor. So what happens is that there is basically two disparities, okay, or two differentials, okay? The high-skilled research and development or decision-making jobs, okay, are usually located in your developed countries. Okay, on the other hand, the low-cost production, low-skilled workers or low-skilled jobs, okay, they tend to be found in the less developed countries or the peripheral areas of your developed countries. So for instance, the less developed parts of a country, basically. Alright, so this is basically what NIDL is all about. Okay, we'll look at what are the reasons or the causes behind this NIDL. Okay, but essentially, you just need to understand that there's basically this difference in the two classes. Okay, some of you guys will have heard of this thing called the North-South Divide, right? It's a development gap. Okay, the NIDL is something that is similar, okay, but we're looking specifically at labor, whereby there is a group of labor, which is the high-skilled, high-educated, okay, they're always located in the developed countries with the presence of good technology, good education systems, while the lower-skilled workers tend to be found in the less developed countries, okay? So if you look at this diagram, okay, you can actually see very clearly the orange parts are basically the peripheral areas or the less developed countries of a continent, a region, or a country. So you notice that largely, okay, you notice that Africa, a bit of South America, as well as this majority part of Asia, tends to have mostly of the lower skilled, okay, level of workers. Okay, for instance, China, right? China has a lot of those. Africa, of course, has a lot of factories, a lot of mining, extraction areas and all. So these are where the lower skilled workers tend to be found, okay, as compared to other areas such as Australia, North America, Singapore, Malaysia area. Okay, these are where the higher skilled, higher educated, higher reskilled jobs, okay, tend to be found in. Alright, so that's basically what the NIDL is. Okay, it's a spatial arrangement of labor. Alright, so what are the causes for this emergence of the NIDL? Okay, there are several causes. Okay, we'll go through it one by one. Firstly, it's because of the standardization and improvement in transport and communication. Alright, so what does this actually mean? Okay, over the years, okay, as technology has advanced, what happened is that there have been discoveries, okay, of new transport technologies, right? So this has actually enhanced the flows of material and products or goods and services, okay, and actually stimulated possibilities for geographical specialization. Okay, what happens is that with advances in technology, okay, advancements in technology, things like air freight, okay, things like shipping, okay, they are all made possible now, okay, whereby goods and services, raw materials can now be transported at a much faster rate. And it can be traveled at a further distance. Okay, it can go from China all the way to America, from America all the way to Singapore. Okay, it can go all over the place. So the emergence of cargo planes or ships, as well as containerization, okay, has made it easy for the movement of such goods on land and over the ocean. Okay, containerization, for those of you guys who don't know, is that, you know, for example, all your ships, right? Essentially, that is what you see, all the huge containers which carries a lot of goods and products and not services, more goods and products. Okay, those are basically what containerization is. Okay, allows for a lot of goods to be stored in one location and transported over long distances without going bad, without having any sort of deformities added onto it. Okay, so this has significantly reduced cost and time involved in moving freight over long distances. In the past, you have to use things like your steampunk trains, or either that you have to use your ships made out of wood, your pirate ships. Okay, yeah, those are kind of things, right? But today, everything has changed, so it's very easy for this stuff to move around. So not only this case, satellite technology has also made possible global communication. So the transmission of information at very high speeds through your internet can actually improve communication. It allows people to strategize over the phone, over the internet. Okay, so it has enhanced a large proportion of business communication amongst firms to actually take place globally. Okay, so why does this actually lead to the emergence of an idea, right? So the whole reason being is that with communication, your higher skilled labor can actually be located in one location. They don't have to be located everywhere, correct? So of course, the higher skilled workers are going to be located in an area whereby there's high technology, whereby there is greater access to basic services, whereby there is essentially high education, right? Good education that's present. So of course, it's going to be located more in your developed countries. Okay, on the other hand, in your less developed countries, because of the containerization, okay, and all these transport technologies, there is no longer a need for factories to be set up in developed countries or for production areas to be set up there, because it can all be located in one location with the lowest cost of labor, whereby there is low skilled workers, so you don't have to pay them as much. Okay, as compared to if your factory is located in a city, right, which actually requires constant maintenance, right, it requires upgrading, and people there are naturally more educated, for instance, or either that of a higher skill. Okay, so that's why there's this emergence of the N idea, right? There's a spatial arrangement because technology and communication transports has actually separated the two, has allowed people to use internet, okay, at one location to actually even converse, okay, with the people who may be in, let's say, these less developed countries. All right, so that's what this has done. It's quite a big factor, technology in this case. All right. The next thing is could be because of the shift towards free trade. So sentiments towards free trade has actually permitted greater movement of capital goods and services between countries without tax. So a lack of tariffs in less developed countries attract TNCs, right? We'll explore what TNCs are in the next few parts to come, okay? But essentially what happens is that because of free trade, right, with a lot of free trade going on, okay, what happens is that TNCs can relocate themselves to areas which have got inherently less educated people, because they acknowledge the fact that with less education, okay, you don't have to increase your wages, okay, there won't be pressure, okay, that is imposed on your wage rates. So as a result, this allows TNCs to come in and exploit the labor, okay, and use low education workers to actually produce low skilled jobs for them. All right, so this is one of the reasons why, okay, free trade. When TNCs or when countries require certain goods and services to be produced, they can always rely on areas with lower education, such that there won't be as much pressure on wages. So this can allow them to exploit, okay, the lower cost of labor that is found over there. Okay, so this is it's a very, very touchy point. Okay, you need to be careful when you talk about free trade. Okay, because you don't want to confuse it with my next point, which is the abundance of low-cost labor in LDCs. Okay, free trade, we're looking more at the fact that TNCs acknowledge the fact that there is low education in certain areas of the world. So they exploit that result, okay, or that factor, okay, that there is low education. Whereas the abundance of low-cost labor is slightly different. Okay, when there is lesser regulation in less developed countries, there is usually going to be lower cost of labor, okay, which has led to TNC setting up in these sites, okay. When there is lesser regulation, okay, chances are global firms or huge companies can actually exploit the labor, okay, not necessarily because the labor may be cheap, okay, but because of the lack of policies that protects these workers. So as a result, TNCs will come in and actually set up all these production plants for these low-skilled workers to actually work. Okay, and so then they would basically pay these workers at a very low wage as well. And because of a lack of unionization, okay, basically lack of unions, trade unions, okay, in many LDCs, okay, this has resulted in no freedom or fight for rights. So it's not exactly the fact that these people may be, let's say, of a lower education standard, or it may be of that they are unable to basically do or contribute to higher skilled jobs. Okay, but it's more of a fact that there's a lack of policies that protect them from being exploited by TNCs who come in and just make them work, okay, at a very, very low cost, okay, and a very, very low wage. Okay, and they can't fight because there's no one to actually help back them up. Alright, so that's the point on abundance of low cost labor. Okay, another cause could be the search for new markets. Alright, so the search for new markets actually is quite self-explanatory, I would think. Okay, the larger the size of a potential market, of course, the more TNCs will be attracted to bring in more revenue. So searching for new markets can also allow for reduced costs with a more diversified supply chain and lessen the chance of inventory storage. Okay, so when there's a search for new markets, okay, TNCs are looking. Okay, they're looking for areas which has got a huge market. For example, India. Okay, naturally, they're going to want to set up there. Okay, and this can actually result in a creation of jobs, okay, be it high or low skilled. Okay, but it also falls under NIDL because it is still involving a spatial arrangement of labor. Right? The amount of labor that is, let's say, hired in this new market, okay, is definitely gonna increase. But not only that, okay, there will be opportunities for lower skilled workers to have a job as well as for higher skilled, okay, because of the creation of, let's say, marketing and sales, research and development. Okay, I've gone through this before. You can go and check it out. I think in my previous video I have gone through a bit on what all these are. Okay, and these basically are what causes, okay, a spatial arrangement of labor, right? Because if you, let's say, set up in India, okay, naturally the cost of labor is gonna be low. So this search for a new market of India is gonna bring in the more production plants and more kind of like an influx, okay, of goods and services that will cater to this new market to allow the TNC to reduce their costs. Okay, so that will set up jobs. It will lead to a greater spatial arrangement of labor as well. Okay, but you know, you will notice that obviously this is a smaller factor that is not exactly as significant as the previous three. Okay, another one could be due to favorable government policy. So this is to attract investments from foreign companies. Greater focus on research and development as well can attract TNCs. Okay, so this one is looking more at developed nations. We're not looking so much at less developed countries. Okay, we're looking at developed nations which have got strong governance, which are able to implement the relevant policies, okay, that can actually attract investments. Okay, for instance, Singapore is a clear example. Okay, we attract FDI over and over again. Huge global companies like Unilever, Coca-Cola, a lot of these huge companies set up research facilities here, okay, simply because of the great policies that we have. Okay, we have got free trade, we encourage investments, right? We have this thing called the 3P Partnership Fund, you can go search it up. Okay, basically it encourages firms to invest, to innovate, okay, new solutions and projects. So these are all reasons why it will attract global firms, okay, to actually come in and set up headquarters here. Okay, especially for countries which have got a reputation, okay, for doing very well in this trade area, okay, for example, Singapore. Alright, so that could be another reason, okay, for NIDL, okay, whereby with these TNCs, they will set up R&D facilities, there'll be jobs for R&D, which is higher skilled, as well as there'll be jobs for regional HQs or HQs that are being set up. Alright, so that's actually all for NIDL, okay, it's quite simple, okay, you just need to understand what the causes are, okay, so exam requirements are quite straightforward as well. Okay, you just need to understand what the spatial variation of NIDL is. Okay, which countries or regions may have the lower skilled labor and which may have the higher skilled. Okay, as well as to explain the factors, okay, that have led to the emergence of NIDL. I've gone through each one of them quite in depth as well. So that is actually all for NIDL. Okay, you just need to have this as kind of like a preamble, okay, to understanding more later on when it comes to what your entire GPN is. Okay, this is one part of the GPN. We'll look at more what then the rest of the GPN is in the next few videos to come. But if not for this part, okay, it can come up for essay questions. So make sure you go and study it, the different factors, and be able to list, okay, relevant examples where applicable as well. If not, that is actually quite about this part. Okay, that's about all, right? I think it's quite a simple part to understand. Right, so if you did enjoy this video, okay, be sure to give it a like as well as to subscribe to the channel. It does help me out a lot and it's free. It doesn't cost you anything, right? And if not, yeah, that's actually all, right? If you have any questions, you can always leave it in the comment section below. I will answer them as well. If not, I will, yes, see you guys in the next one, right? Have a good one. Study hard. Bye-bye.